I entered the profession against my will, and I said it is a parasitic profession and all that. But you know, the legend of the profession is something which is fascinating. You know, you hear of great trials, great cross-examination, great lawyers. You know, it's a dream. It's your dream to fight for liberty. It's such a fascinating, very romantic subject. But then I never thought that my boon will be granted with such plenty.
Welcome to the K.G. Kannabiran Lectures on Law, Justice and Human Rights. It is now a decade since Kannabiran passed on. He was a man, take him all in all. I shall not look upon his like again. That was Hamlet. Kannabiran was a self-taught and self-made man. In a profession where godfathers and family and class meant everything, he rose from humble beginnings to legendary heights through sheer dedication and hard work. A prolific reader, he devoured every piece of literature that came his way as he struggled through school, college, and practice. It was precisely that reading which expanded his mind. What forged him into a legend was a sensitive and brilliant defense of political dissidents and revolutionaries who were hunted down by the state during the emergency. He converted the courtroom into a literary convention, often asking his clients to recite poetry or explain the philosophy for which they were charged to the judge. He prided himself on his radical interpretation of the law, often educating the judges before whom he appeared to interpret the spirit and intent of the Constitution. He was admired and loved for his fearless defense of causes, coupled with a deep tenderness for his poorer clients, which made him a much loved figure in Andhra Pradesh. He inspired many young lawyers searching for some meaning and radical dimensions in the practice of law. As president of the Andhra Pradesh Civil Liberties Committee and the People's Union of Civil Liberties, he was critical to expanding these movements to powerful institutions of human rights defense. He was involved in human rights work across the country, which was idolized and adored, particularly in his home state, Andhra Pradesh, by the poor and disempowered and often resented by rich and powerful people unless they had a case or a cause they needed him to fight. It is now a decade since his death, and given the state of human rights today, his presence is sorely missed. This is an effort to preserve his heritage for the bright young lawyers who are emerging today, a generation that he sincerely believed would restore decency, dignity, and justice to our country. Thank you.
The family of K.G. Kannabiran welcomes you to the K.G. Kannabiran Lectures on Law, Justice, and Human Rights. 10 years after his death, we remember his spirit, his resistance, and his constitutional insurgencies in courts and through courts and tribunals, in defense of dissent, personal liberty, associational freedoms, and justice, speaking truth to power, calling for judicial accountability and state accountability, especially in the matter of repressive laws, custodial violence, and extrajudicial murders, encounter killings, calling out entrenched practices of discrimination and structural violence, and setting out the basic structures of constitutional rule. We bring together a few of the lawyers and judges who knew him personally and worked with him on cases, campaigns, and tribunals to remember their collaborations with him and reflect on future pathways of this important slice of the history of lawyering for human rights and civil liberties, rooted in the Indian experience. K.G. Kannabiran lived and worked in Andhra Pradesh, in Hyderabad. He traveled across the country, appearing in courts of trial and high courts and in people's tribunals and fact-finding missions. from Kashmir, Assam and Manipur to Tamil Nadu, Chhattisgarh to Gujarat to Punjab, Karnataka and beyond. Within Andhra, every nook and corner, every forest and town bear his footprints. Practically every court in every jurisdiction in the state bears his imprint. Every university, meeting hall, meeting ground has heard him speak untiringly on the meanings of the rule of law and the constitution. No place was out of bounds in his quest for justice. We hope to remember him through the futures of his work and through the work of those who carry it forward in so many different ways. In this specific segment of lectures, we bring together the voices of those who shared his calling. Mihir Desai is Vice President of People's Union for Civil Liberties, the organization of which K.G. Kanabiran was National President for 15 years, from 1995 till his death in 2010. A senior advocate, Mihir Desai has been practicing criminal matters in Bombay High Court, Mumbai, and the Supreme Court of India. He is a human rights lawyer who has taken up cases of mass communal violence and caste violence, state violence, free speech, and the rights of journalists and political dissenters. He has closely been involved in fact-finding missions and citizens' tribunals on questions of human rights in India. Desai is co-founder of the Indian People's Tribunal and the Human Rights Law Network, and is a former director of the India Center for Human Rights and Law. He was a co-founder of the human rights magazine Combat Law and has represented survivors of the 2002 Gujarat massacre. He currently represents the accused in the ongoing Bhima Koregaon cases, among others.
I'm extremely thankful to Kalpana as well as Vasant for giving me this opportunity of speaking in the memory of somebody who one always considered to be the doyen of the human rights movement in India. Not just as a lawyer, but also as an activist. I did not have the opportunity of working with him on a legal brief, but I've had many opportunities of reading his various works, various articles, reports. I've had the opportunity of participating with him in various meetings, various fact-finding tribunals. In fact, Mr. Kannabiran passed away before the present national regime of Mr. Modi came about. But and possibly if he was alive, he might have been in jail today. But looking at the way things are going, but I do remember that in 2002, after the riots in Gujarat, when Mr. Modi was the chief minister, we had together participated in the tribunal, in an exhaustive tribunal, which went on over weeks, concerning the violence in Gujarat. So I have, and of course one has met him many times otherwise also, so one, the memories are very, very fond of Mr. Kannabiran. And everybody knows that his passion was as a lawyer for the defense in most of the cases, of course. So his passion was for the lawyer for the defense. And his critical insight, and I feel that his book, The Wages of Impunity, is a compulsory, it should be made a compulsory reading in all law institutions and even non-law institutions where social sciences are being taught. There is one thing which he in the book, I'll just like to quote from what he says. He says that while the rule of law is a civilizing factor, it is at the same time an instrument that facilitates the uncritical acceptance of the deployment of violence for governance and to justify war. This interplay of violence and power has little to do with the ideologies that states or government profess. And this is precisely what I'm going to elaborate and talk about today. But before I do that, I just wanted to quote one more paragraph from another article from the same book, where he says that political discontent, which was genuine to start with, has never since been examined and no attempts have been made to resolve it. Instead, discontent has been allowed to fester until it could be dealt with later as a law and order issue. That is, discontent was outlawed de facto without overtly banning the activity. After the 44th Amendment, it was no longer possible to invoke emergency provision to contain internal disturbance. They can only be invoked when there is a threat of armed rebellion within. When this amendment was brought about, the obvious intention was to prevent the state from frequently and on the slightest pretext resorting to emergency provisions to impose an arbitrary authoritarian rule. Ironically, this amendment seems to have given more space to the executive to introduce repressive legislation without the necessity of suspending any of the fundamental rights. And then he goes on to speak about how TADA, etc., were introduced. By the 44th Amendment permitting such enactments to be introduced. So while he's a major critique of the emergency period, but even post-emergency, his insights are quite amazing in various aspects which he covers in the book. Let me just go into the two issues which he was very passionate about, and about which he has written, and on which he has handled hundreds of cases. One is the issue concerning preventive detention, the detention laws, and second was about the special legislation such as TADA and POTA, and UAPA to a large extent only during the later part, or during the last part of his life, the amendments to the UAPA. The reason why I want to go into it is because if one looks at the situation today, we need to put the detention laws as well as the UAPA laws in their context. Now, remember one thing, that most of the detention laws came not necessarily during the NDA government or during the BJP government. Many of them have come, or most majority of them came through the constitution and thereafter through various legislations passed by various Congress governments. We have to be clear about that. And the reason why I'm going into these two aspects, so the preventive detention as well as the special anti-terror laws, as they call it, okay, is because these are the laws which allow the state to carve out exception for its own lawlessness. Okay. These are the laws which permit the state to, on the one hand, say that we are governed by the rule of law, and on the other hand, pass such legislations which violates the rule of law altogether. These are the laws which go against the basic tenet of constitution, such as freedom, equality, right to life and liberty, etc., etc. So these are the laws, while they are within the framework of rule of law, are actually in violation of the rule of law. And that's why it becomes important to look at these laws, which gives an exceptional power to the state over citizens to arrest them, to detain them, to charge them with offenses which otherwise they may not be able to charge them with, keep them behind bars for years together. And these are the laws which have been used systematically over the period of time for keeping people behind the bars for a long time, as also for ensuring that dissent in any form is crushed. Now, the reason why these laws become important today is because if you look at the last 5 or 6 years, I feel there has been a consistent and strong hollowing out of the institutes of accountability which are required in a democracy. Yeah. Now, what are these institutions? And in that context, I would like to look at these laws and how they are being used today. In what context? How, why do I say that there is a hollowing out? Now, if you see, under the constitution as well as under various legislations. A palam, the executive as well as the legislature, are required to be accountable to people in various ways. The one obvious way we know is, of course, elections every 5 years. Okay, that's one way of being accountable. But apart from elections, there are various institutions set up, such as the Election Commission, such as the Controller and Auditor General of India, such as the Parliament itself, such as the Lokayukta, such as the Right to Information Act, and various provisions under that act. So these are various provisions by which you can hold the executive as well as the judiciary, legislature accountable. And what we have seen is consistently there has been an erosion of these institutions. And one can go on giving examples of how this erosion has happened, but just to give one or two examples, if you look at the Election Commission, okay, you had 5 orders in the last election, okay, where out of the 3 election commissioners, 1 election commission says that that Mr. Modi and Mr. Shah, Mr. Modi has violated the code of conduct. Okay, one of the election commissions says on 5 occasions. On all 5 occasions, the other 2 disagree. Now, that's fine. Other 2 disagree. But they don't allow the dissent to be recorded. They don't allow the dissent to come out in public. Okay? And then what happens is this very election commissioner who gives a dissenting opinion, he and his wife face immediately income tax ordeals. Okay? The law is used, okay, in order to threaten them, in order to terrorize them. And finally, what happens? Finally, he leaves. This gentleman leaves. Okay. So that is as far as the Election Commission is concerned. A similar thing happens for instance, the CBI. Where the CBI, we all know how there was a dispute between the director and the joint director of CBI. Finally, the director was removed, apparently because he wanted to go and investigate the Rafael deal. He was removed overnight, though there was no power to remove him. He was removed overnight. Somebody else was placed in his, put in his place, etc., etc. So every institution, and judiciary, we know, initially the attempt was to somehow create a problem within the judiciary through NJSC, that is the National Judicial Commission, for appointment of judges of the higher courts. Supreme Court struck it down. But they have found a way around it. The executive has found a way around it, and it has been able to put pressure on the judiciary in various ways, either through the IB, either through not responding to any request from the judiciary, either through possibly helping the judiciary out, individual members of the judiciary out when they are in trouble, such as a trouble with sexual harassment case, or such as a trouble with a chief minister dying, committing suicide and naming some of the judges. So in all these respects, the executive has been able to, what one can say, tame the judiciary. Similar thing is with the RBI. You had first Rajan, who was removed because he did not agree. Then they put their own man, Urjit Patel, who also did not agree. So he was removed. A third person has been brought in. So you have a hollowing out of Lokayukta, hardly functions. Nobody was appointed for a long time. CAG, now they have Mr. Murmu, who has been appointed as the head of the CAG, who was the principal secretary during the Gujarat violence in Gujarat during CM Modi's time, and who is under a lot of cloud for various other reasons. Parliament itself is not allowed to function properly because you have a situation whereby like this time you saw the question hour was taken away. You have various laws being passed as money bills, making Rajya Sabha redundant. You have the entire office of leader of opposition being done away with, because of which what happens is that that on many of the appointment committees you don't have any leader of opposition. So what the chief prime minister says goes through. So there is a constant hollowing out of various institutions of accountability, apart from three other things, which are basically, if you look at educational institutions, a complete erosion of autonomy of educational institutions, violence being used within the educational institution, state violence being used, whether it's Aligarh, whether it's Jamia, whether it's JNU, one sees that constantly happening. You have similarly the media being completely placed under control. Either the channels are owned by some people from the government, or through the method of advertising, or through method of now using the UAPA to arrest journalists, bringing out a chilling effect on the journalists. So these are various ways. And finally, the civil society organizations attacked in various ways, either by filing cases against them or using the FCRA, either through amendment of FCRA or by cancelling FCRAs, foreign contribution registration licenses, thereby preventing them from acting as effectively as they want to. So there are various ways in which the dissent of any kind is being crushed in our country today. And the two laws which are used primarily nowadays for crushing the dissent are UAPA, that is Unlawful Activities Prevention Act, and the various preventive detention laws, including the NSA, okay, which was used against Dr. Khalil in the context of what had happened in Uttar Pradesh, Dr. Khalil. But let me just go back. Yeah. Before I go into UAPA and preventative, if you see that in 1919, you had this famous Rowlatt Act being passed. Yeah. What did the Rowlatt Act provide? Rowlatt Act provided essentially that up to 2 years, persons could be kept in jail without trial. So it was a preventive detention law for 2 years without trial and search without warrant. This is what was the Rowlatt Act. It's popularly known as Rowlatt Act. It was actually titled as Anarchical and Revolutionary Crimes Act at that point of time, and there was a huge protest against that. And one of the most significant symbol of the protest is the Jallianwala Bagh massacre, where the meeting took place to protest against Rowlatt Act, to protest against preventive detention laws, which people felt would be misused. Yeah. And of course, then thereafter, the Gandhiji's Satyagraha started, the non-cooperation movement, civil disobedience movement, etc. started. And after 3-4 years, this act had to be withdrawn. Yeah. Because our national movement and its leaders believed that this law was what they called at that time, maybe inappropriately, black law. Okay? And that it needed to go because it allowed the police executive power to preventively detain people. After that, of course, once the law was forced to be withdrawn, then you had the Defense of India Act, Defense of India Rules, which came in the 30s and again once the war started in 42. So the question came in during the Constituent Assembly debates and thereafter as to what do you do with preventive detention? I mean, do you have, because throughout the national movement had always opposed preventive detention. They said, you charge a person, you convict a person, you jail a person, which is one thing. But without charging a person, without convicting a person, how can you put him behind bars? Freedom movement was about freedom. So you can't put people behind bars unless you charge them, unless there is some kind of a conviction. How can you put them behind bars? So this was a major debate during the Constituent Assembly, that can we have preventive detention or not? Finally, for whatever reasons, okay, it was agreed, and I think it was wrongly agreed, to have preventive detention law as part of the Constitution. I mean, the Constitution Article 22 permits preventive detention, But in limited circumstances, like it says that a preventive detention can only be done for maximum of 3 months, and more than that, only if Parliament allows through a law, only after referring to a review committee. So limited preventive detention for 3 months, and more than that, only if a review committee actually goes through the grounds of detention and finds it justifiable. Detention committee being review committee being headed by somebody who is capable of being qualified to be a high court judge, etc. And only after that it can be, and more than that, only if the parliament by law prescribes. This is the constitution. 26 January is the constitution. Immediately after the constitution is formulated, you have a first preventive detention law. Now, this first preventive detention law had a sunset clause. Okay. Namely, it will be there for 1 year, 2 years, and at the end of 2 years, it will be reviewed and seen whether it should be continued or it should be removed. Okay. This went on till 67. Okay. Every 2 years, the law was renewed, and it went on till 67. 67, the Congress government lost about six state assemblies and felt that one of the reasons why we needed to we lost is because this preventive detention is being misused. So they allowed it to lapse. But then in another year's time, 2 years' time, MISA came. Okay. Now, MISA was again, it was a preventive detention law, Maintenance of Internal Security Act. And MISA again was misused, and MISA became a symbol of government lawlessness during the emergency. So MISA was repealed after the emergency. And in 1980, the National Security Act came, which is now the present act, which deals with preventive detention, allowing preventive detention up to 1 year. This, unlike the earlier, unlike what happened in 50s and 60s, was not a law meant for a year, 2 years, 3 years. The oppressive law, that is Preventive Detention Act, which initially was supposedly temporary, okay, now acquired a permanence, okay, in 1980 by NSA being a permanent law for preventive detention. It is no more subject to parliamentary scrutiny every year, 2 years, something like that. It's become a part of permanent, it's a permanent fixture of our laws. Now, a similar thing has happened with UAPA, and that's why I just wanted to go into this. The other exception law. Okay? One is, of course, the preventive detention law, which is an exception law, and the other exception law are the terrorist laws. Now, before 84, 85, before 1985, you did not have any anti-terror laws in India, so to speak. If anybody committed an act of terrorism, he could be tried. If somebody died, you can be tried for murder. You can be tried for rioting. You could be tried for attempt to murder. You can be tried for dacoity. You can be tried for whatever you want. In 1985, soon after the violence against the Sikhs in 1984, the TADA was brought in. Terrorists. First in 1984, before 1985, actually there was another act brought in, yeah, which was basically a precursor to TADA for 1 year. It was a Terrorist Affected Areas Act, which delineated certain areas which could be delineated as terrorist affected, and special laws be applied there. It was replaced by TADA in 1985. And TADA for the first time. Now, what did TADA do which the other laws did not permit? Okay. Apart from defining what is a terrorist activity, etc. It did three, four things. And I think that's why it's important to understand how TADA was different from the normal law. Now, under the normal law, what happens is that under the normal criminal procedure code, there are two rights available to a person who is likely to be arrested or who is arrested. The first right is that I have a right to apply for anticipatory bail. even if I am charged with murder, I can still apply for anticipatory bail. If the court is satisfied that the grounds against me are not strong enough, the court can very well say that grant him anticipatory bail, there is no need to arrest him. Impose certain conditions, but don't arrest him. Now, TADA does away with anticipatory bail. So if I am likely to be arrested under TADA, I cannot avail of anticipatory bail. Similarly, as far as bail is concerned, ordinarily what happens is that once you are arrested, the court will find out whether you are likely to abscond, you are likely to tamper with evidence or not, and put some conditions, and after some time grant you bail. But under TADA, there was a special provision which says that you cannot grant bail to somebody unless the court comes to the conclusion that the person is not guilty of such offenses. Okay. So at the stage of bail, before even the evidence is led, before even the trial begins, okay, the court should come to a conclusion that the person is not guilty of such offense. And only then a bail can be granted. So one can imagine how many people would have been granted bail. Hardly anybody. Okay. So bail was basically denied, which is otherwise a right, bail, not jail, is the principle which is supposed to be followed. It's otherwise a right. So bail was denied. Third thing, ordinarily what happens is the police custody is for 15 days. Okay. Once you are arrested, 15 days police custody, where police torture you, etc., etc. Now it was extended to 1 month. And the charge sheet gives you the grounds on which you are arrested finally. Okay. The charge sheet normally would have to be filed within 60 days. Okay. Under this act, there was an extended period of 1 year, okay, given in order to file a charge sheet. Okay. Which means what? That for 1 year, you don't even know what the detailed grounds on which you are arrested. You won't get bail because no judge is going to say you are not guilty if nobody knows why you are arrested. So nobody is going to give you bail. So effectively what it meant is that it allowed preventive detention for 1 year without taking recourse to preventive detention laws. Okay? This is what TADA did. Okay? Apart from that, so this was one thing. Apart from that, what happened is that there was a certain kind of privilege given to witnesses. If the judge felt that certain witness was sensitive or something like that, or the accused was not entitled to know the name of the witness. So you can imagine the kind of problem it was. Similarly, confession of a co-accused, which otherwise is not admissible in law, was made admissible. There was a presumption, okay, and there was a that suppose you are found at a place where arms are found, okay, or suppose your fingerprints are found in some place where there is an explosion, okay, you might be a passerby, you might be anybody, then there is a presumption that you are a terrorist, and the presumption has to be rebutted by you. So this was the end, and there could be various attachment of your property, etc., etc. So this was the situation as far as TADA is concerned. This is how TADA was brought in 85. But TADA had one thing. TADA had a sunset clause. TADA had to be reviewed every 2 years, okay, by the parliament. So every 2 years it would go back before the parliament, and then the parliament would have to decide, okay, as to whether to continue or not. TADA was taken to Supreme Court. Supreme Court upheld the validity of TADA with certain exceptions, certain generalizations. It upheld the validity of TADA. But finally, you see, what was found was there were major protests against TADA. And the reason was this, that in 1994, there were 70,000 under trials in India, across India, under TADA. They had not been subjected to trial, etc., etc. Many of them were inside for years together because the trial had not started. And the rate of conviction under TADA, burden of proof has shifted. Witnesses can be confidential against you. Confessions made by you can be used against a co-accused, etc. And also, again, another thing that confession made to a police inspector, police officer, was permitted, unlike under normal criminal law, where the confession has to be made before a magistrate. So that, so despite all these flexibilities and relaxations in the criminal law, okay, the conviction rate under TADA in 1994 was 1%. Okay? 1%. Okay? Compared to the overall conviction in normal crimes being 44% at that point of time. Okay? So you had 1% conviction rate in TADA. You had a massive misuse of TADA. You had people who were, who had nothing to do with terrorism, persons who were basically opposed to rises in milk price in Gujarat being arrested under TADA. You had people who were striking for their genuine rights as workers being arrested under TADA. So TADA was, and it had become a big problem. So finally in 1995, the central government allowed TADA to lapse. So TADA lapses in 1995, and that's the end of TADA. Of course, the existing trials under TADA continue, but TADA lapses, okay, in 1995. After that, what happens is that in 2000, okay, the government, after that, what happens is that you have in 2000, the government asking, forming a committee to decide whether you need a permanent law for dealing with terrorism. 2001, two events happen. One is, of course, the famous World Center, World Trade Center attacks in New York, and the Parliament attack in December in India. Using this as a reason, they come out with what is known as PoTO, Prevention of Terrorism Ordinance. This is before the end, which later on gets converted to POTA. Okay, so PoTO is brought out, and this is converted into POTA in the later year. Again, this is similar to TADA, very similar to TADA. Two or three differences. One is here also, this is subject to a sunset clause in the sense that every 3 years it has to be reviewed. And unless it's specifically continued by the parliament, it would stand repealed. Instead of 2 years earlier under TADA, it is 3 years. The confession, which was still permissible to be made to a police officer and not necessarily to a judge, magistrate, was admissible in evidence, but not against a co-accused, unlike it was in the TADA. You had one other important thing, two other important things which were set up here. One was a review committee was set up, which would review the cases, okay, of people charged under TADA, a review committee set up by the government, which would review the cases of people charged under TADA and see whether these cases under TADA should be continued or not. So there was a kind of a filter, okay, a review committee. And as far as bail is concerned, there was it was like in TADA that unless the court finds him not guilty, but that condition was to apply only for the first year of the bail, first year of the arrest. Then after first year of the arrest, your normal bail conditions of criminal procedure code would apply. So after the first, so for the first year, this stringent condition, but after first year of arrest, the normal bail conditions, so people would start getting bail. Again, the problem with POTA was it was misused massively. You had politicians being arrested, you had people who were striking, who were people who were protesting against against their houses being demolished, being arrested, etc., etc. So all these things happened. And even before that, what had happened was that POTA was opposed even when it was brought in as an act by the opposition parties. So it could not be passed through Rajya Sabha. And at that time, one of the unique times when the parliament called a joint parliamentary session of Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha and could only then pass the law POTA. But anyway, there was a lot of opposition in and Congress in 2004, UPA, one of its, this thing was that we'll do away with POTA if we come to power. So when they came to power, POTA was done away with. It was done away with. Repealed Pota. Repealed in the, yeah, repealed Pota. Anyway, there was a sunset clause, they repealed Pota. So Pota was repealed. After that, on the same day that they repealed Pota, they brought out an amendment to the UAPA Act, that is Unlawful Activities Prevention Act. Okay. Now, Unlawful Activities Prevention Act already existed in the law book since 1967. Okay. But that law essentially dealt with banning certain organizations. Okay. It was not a law dealing with terrorism. It was a law dealing with banning certain organizations which spoke against unity, integrity of India, and which talked about secession, which supported secession, etc. So ban certain organization, and then if you are part of those organizations, then you could be punished, etc., etc. So that was what UAPA law was. 2004, the amendment which was brought about, and then there was subsequent amendment in 2008, 2013, and then now 2019. Okay. Basically, it incorporated the provisions concerning terrorism from POTA into UAPA. So while POTA is repealed, you have UAPA coming in with similar kind of provisions with minor changes here and there. But at the same time, so you have here two or three, under UAPA, there are two or three things which we must focus on. One is that there is something called unlawful activity and unlawful associations. Now, unlawful associations are those which from time to time will be declared as unlawful if that association is found to be acting against unity, integrity of India, or talking about secession, or talking about some part seceding from India, etc., etc. Then an organization can be declared as unlawful through an official government gazette notification issued from time to time. So that's one thing, unlawful activity. Second is terrorist organizations. Terrorist organizations are those which are named in the schedule to the act itself. Now there are more than 40 organizations named in the schedule to the act itself, which are classified as terrorist organization. So that's the second thing. Okay. And then there are other offenses which are related. Now, essentially, over a period of time, you see, through amendments, what has happened is that the same provisions of POTA are now brought in here into UAPA. So repealing POTA really didn't make any damn of a difference, okay, to what kind of act would now come into place. Not only that, I personally feel there are at least three issues, okay? Three things which are worse in UAPA than POTA. Okay? First is that under POTA, as I mentioned, there was a review committee which used to filter the cases. Only if the review committee allowed could a sanction be granted to prosecute somebody under POTA. Review committees are completely done away with under UAPA. Second thing is, under POTA, as I mentioned earlier, the strict bail conditions, which effectively denied you bail altogether, would apply only for 1 year. And after that, the normal bail conditions of criminal procedure code would apply. This has been done away with in POTA, in UAPA. That means what? That forever and after, till the trial is over, the strict bail conditions would continue to apply. So you will, it's very, very unlikely that you will get bail. That's the second thing. The third thing is that both UAPA and both TADA and POTA had, as I mentioned, sunset clauses. 2 years, 3 years, just as the preventive detention initially had. And just as the preventive detention, the temporary law initially got converted into a permanent law in 1980. Similarly, UAPA acquired the character of a permanent anti-terrorism law without any sunset clause. The advantage of sunset clause is that it's supposed to be reviewed. It has to be placed before the parliament. It has to be debated in the parliament. Here, there is no reason for any debate. There is no justification for debate, etc., etc. And you can just simply continue with this law forever and after. So UAPA in that sense is a much more oppressive law than POTA or TADA ever were. We have to remember that. Now look at the way the UAPA is. I'll just look, having talked about this, I'll just talk about the ways in which UAPA, briefly speak about the ways in which UAPA has been used in the current times, in the present times, and why it is absolutely essential that one doesn't call for dilution of UAPA, one calls for repeal of UAPA. Now, remember one thing. There are at least three cases going on right now where UAPA has been majorly used. Yeah. Which are those three cases? One is the Bhima Koregaon case, which has happened in Maharashtra, but which has acquired a national flavor. Okay. Where everybody has been charged with some kind, everybody who is arrested is charged as being a terrorist, and put behind bars. Whether that person has anything to do with terrorism, whether that person has ever entered Bhima Koregaon, whether that person ever entered a forest is irrelevant. You are charged with this and you are put behind bars. That's one thing. Second case is the Delhi riots case, okay, where the victims have become now the accused. Through the UAPA. UAPA has been used against various people saying that actually those who are victims and those who called for peaceful protests, those who always supported Gandhian ideals of peaceful satyagraha and non-violence have been now charged as being terrorists and have been put behind bars. And many more people are likely to be arrested. Similarly, in the Hathras case, the third case, where the girl was mercilessly raped and beaten and killed. Her body burnt overnight. By a total collaboration between the police and the upper class men. And what is happening now? Journalists who try to go and investigate what's happening are being charged under UAPA as being terrorists, as being performing unlawful activities, etc. etc. Now, remember, as I told you, and the reason why, and what is happening now is just coming back to what I was trying to say, that what is happening now is the use of the law. You see, there are various ways in which you can crush dissent, or you can quieten dissent. As I said, one of the ways, one of the ways is by hollowing out various institutions. That is one way in which you curb dissent. You hollow out Lokayukta, you hollow out the Supreme Court, you hollow out Parliament, etc., etc. You control the civil society organizations and you control the press. The media. Okay? These are the ways in which you do it. What the government, it is not as if UAPA was not misused earlier. Please remember that. It is not as if as if TADA or preventive detention law was not misused earlier. It was misused massively. Many people would say the worst atrocities happened during the emergency 75-77. But remember two things. That emergency was a phenomena to protect an individual or one or two individuals. Okay. As soon as those people felt protected, emergency was lifted. Okay. It was a temporary event, okay, for 2 years. And therefore, as soon as the temporary event is over, things start getting normalized. Presently, you are not dealing with a temporary event. You are dealing with the spread of an ideology, okay, which seeks to establish permanence in our society, okay, which seeks to establish itself as the only ideology which will be acceptable in the society. Okay. In order to do that, it has to root out dissent. It has to root out any kind of objections to the way it functions. And it will use legal as well as extra-legal methods of doing so. Various extra-legal methods can be used, such as individual killings, like we saw Gauri Lankesh, Dabolkar, and various other. But individual killings only kill that individual create some sort of a chilling effect for the time being, and then people again start protesting. With these kind of conspiracy cases which they are building up, Bhima Koregaon, Delhi, etc., okay, what they are doing is they may not be killing an individual, but they are creating an atmosphere of fear which will last, which will affect not one individual, but a large number of people, like everywhere, 20 people arrested, 40 people arrested, 50 people arrested, etc. So it will affect a large number of people, and it will affect them for a long period of time till the trial ends. So another 8 years, 10 years, 15 years. So imagine the chilling effect of these kind of trials, especially on people who are seen as leaders of the civil society. Okay? They are no more interested so much on the foot soldiers. Okay? They are interested in attacking whom they consider are the leaders of the society. And they are using this law, UAPA, to keep people behind bars, irrespective of whether conviction comes or not, keep people behind bars for a long, long period of time. And therefore, I personally feel, and they have acquired a mastery at using this law, UAPA Act, brand anybody as anti-national, brand anybody as violent, brand anybody as urban Naxal, put them behind bars. Let them be in the behind bars for years and years together. Nobody, and the judiciary has been pathetically bad as far as responding to these kind of cases, whether it was the Romila Thapar's case in Supreme Court, or whether it's a recent case called Wadali's case of the Supreme Court, where the Supreme Court said that at the time of granting bail, the court will not look at the admissibility of evidence which the police produce. So police produce any fabricated documents, and the courts are not supposed to look at them till the trial is over. And trial will be over maybe 8 years, 10 years, 15 years from now. Till that time, you stay in jail. So this law, okay, its use, it's not a misuse, its use is to keep people behind bars for years and years together without there being any justifiable cause. Okay. And therefore, I feel that it's time that we all demand that a law like UAPA be repealed altogether. You don't need a law like, in order to fight terrorism, you don't need a law like UAPA. You have enough provisions under the IPC, and under various other laws, various provisions. Like if somebody commits murder, you charge him with murder under IPC. Somebody commits dacoity, you charge that person with dacoity. Somebody commits hate speech, there are already provisions in IPC. There, somebody commits sedition, there is a provision. I don't agree with it, but it's there. Somebody wages a war against the government, there is a specific offense for waging war against the government under IPC. So you don't need these separate offenses. Okay? You don't need this separate law. Okay, to deal with it. The separate law is needed only in order to crush dissent. And that's what it is being used for. And that's why we should all ask for it to be repealed. Thank you very much. And let me just say at the end that we do miss Mr. Kannavinan at this time, because this is the time when I believe that his ideas, his strength as a lawyer and his strength as a human rights activist is badly needed. Unfortunately, we don't have it, have him with him, but we still have his ideals and his principles to go by. And let's try and go by that, and let's see how much forward we can move. Thank you very much.